The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Jesus said to his disciples, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord. Jesus says to his disciples, those who abide in me dwell in me, and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen. So, a short discursive before I get into the meat of the sermon. This is one of those Sundays when trying to figure out which lesson to preach on is almost impossible because they are all such rich, full descriptions. And, you know, the God is love thing from 1 John is just so wonderful. How can you not preach it? Well, one of the things that gets me to choose what to preach is rubs me the wrong way. What rubs against me and my natural inclinations, what I find difficult to preach. And I find difficult to preach, apart from me, you can do nothing. This is such a stark statement by Jesus. Apart from me, you do not have the power to do anything. And to unpack this stark truth, let me tell you a story, a fable, if you will, that shines the light of the Christian gospel on today's world. But first remember this, at the heart of our Anglican tradition, our Christian tradition, roots itself in our union with God and intimately expresses itself in this notion of mutual indwelling, abiding in God, even as God abides in us, dwelling in God, even as God dwells within us, standing fast in a union of loyalty and love. Remember the heart of Thomas Cranmer's prayer of humble access says this, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under God's table, but God's property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son Jesus and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. And in our gospel lesson today, Jesus fleshes out this union, this joining together in loyalty and love in the metaphor of the grapevine. Now, I have a long-standing love-hate relationship with vines. My home in Pensacola on this hot, humid bayou was fertile ground for a variety of vines to flourish. Ferocious tree-eating vines that cannot do anything good. Vines that can grow over a foot in a day, grow so fast that small pets must be careful where they take a nap. Indian sweet potato, Virginia crawler, Confederate jasmine, and worst of all, the fearsome scuppernong vine, the wild grapevine native to the South and the bane of my existence. The scuppernong grape is a tasty, thick-walled grape. You squeeze the grape with your fingers and it bursts, and the sweet-sour flesh jumps into your mouth. But it is a grapevine that covers trees like a blanket, and it is almost impossible to kill. I pull them, chop them, dig them out, all to no avail. They laugh at Roundup. And they sneer at my puny efforts to eliminate them. And I can tell you that the effete grapevines of Europe are no match for our vines. The European grapevines cannot grow in America because over here lives the dreaded Phylloxera vatistrix, which means the dry leaf devastator. And nothing, nobody wants a parasite nicknamed the devastator. It's an aphid that infects every level of the vine from the leaf to the root. A near microscopic bug that sticks its snout into the vine, sucks out its sap, and leaves behind a poison that keeps the sap flowing, weakening the vine, girdling its roots, and killing it. For millennia, of course, grapevines flourished in Europe. Europe was an Eden where the best wines were and still are made. Wines to provide safe drinking, great feasts, and sacraments, right? And then in the 1850s, some amateur English botanists, in their innocent and ignorant glee, brought some vine cuttings from America to England and introduced the serpent into Eden's garden. In 1863, the devastator jumps to the continent, and by 1890, the devastator kills 90% of all European grapevines. Dead grapevines everywhere, the wine industry in tatters. All attempts to create resistant hybrids are effective pesticides are a complete and total failure to this day. The European vines have no way in themselves to cure themselves. And the only way to save the European grape is to graft the European vine onto the stock of American grapevines. The European vines are able to do what they cannot do on their own, only with united with the naturally resistant American rootstock. To resist the effects of the devastator and to flourish, American vines restore the vineyards of Europe. And in union with American vines, the branches may produce good fruit, fruit capable of making great wines for the feast. So let's graft this story onto the roots of our Christian story, the story of sin and salvation. In the Garden of Eden, God forms us in God's image, creates us to dwell with God in the garden, to tend the vineyards. But a serpent introduces the devastation of sin into the garden. Sin separates us from God, the vineyard keeper, and on our own, we are completely unable to produce good fruit. Sin infects every level of our humanity. Our thoughts and our emotions, our souls and our bodies, our traditions and our communities. And in ourselves, we have no remedy. We toil and sweat to produce good fruit, but thorns and weeds spring up and choke our vines, storms and pestilence rain down on all our efforts. Now God, the vineyard keeper, tries many solutions. He chooses Israel to tend his vineyard. And when Israel repeatedly falls away from God, as people are wont to do, God gives the gift of the law. Then God sends prophets to preach repentance, all to no avail. And then God begins the final plan of salvation. God sends His only, His beloved Jesus, into the world to reveal the fullness of God to a devastated humanity. When God unites us to Jesus at baptism, God unites us to Jesus in His death, so that we may rise again with new and eternal life, united to Jesus. At baptism, we put on the robe of Christ, this white robe that I wear here. In the bread and wine, we take Christ into ourselves, so that really, literally, we dwell in Christ, and Christ dwells in us. Rooted only in ourselves, we are lost. But grafted onto the rootstock of Christ, the gracious love and loyalty of Jesus to us, and our response of love and loyalty to Jesus, we gain the possibility of producing fruit in this life and the hope of producing completely good fruit in the next. And so we strive in Christ to make good wine now. But full fruition waits for that last great day, when the new creation comes in fullness, the general resurrection to come when Jesus returns in glory. And this is our tradition, from Jesus to Paul to Augustine, from Augustine to Calvin to Cranmer, from Thomas Cranmer to us. And John Calvin wrote that we remain always able fool ourselves, to believe that we may obtain goodness through our own efforts. But in fact, we are totally unable to do anything ourselves, anything that might free us from the stranglehold of sin. And in his inimitable style, Calvin writes, and if I were to preach this, you would run out of the room, what Calvin writes sometimes. But Calvin writes, humanity, so far from being just before God, is but rottenness and a worm, abominable and vain, drinking in iniquity like water. We are all capable of being good in ourselves. We need divine help. We are dependent on our union with the rootstock of Jesus, that union of loyalty and love that's possible through the grace of our Lord. Sin. Everyone underestimates sin. Sin is not simply a matter of bad deeds. Goodness is not simply a matter of doing good deeds. Sin is a disease that infects humanity, all humanity, and its devastation infects every level of human society. So as important as personal piety is, and it is very important, salvation is never merely about personal piety. We cannot wall ourselves off and live in a cell or live faithfully only in a relationship of me and God. We are all interconnected because we are social beings. We are human only in relationship with other human beings. When Jesus speaks of himself as the true vine and of you as the branches, he says that rooted in Jesus, united in Christ, we are all branches of one vine. The you is plural and embraces all of us disciples. And the you is inclusive because Jesus comes to save the world. As John writes, Jesus is the atoning sacrifice for our sin, and not for ours only, but for the sin of the whole world. Moreover, that whole world is not just the earth. It is the whole cosmos. Jesus dies and rose for the restoration of the whole creation. So for now, from systemic and systematic racism to the hashtag MeToo movement, from the vicious tribalism of our political discourse to the epidemics of suicide and addiction, current events show all of us how intractable the devastation of sin is, how vain our efforts to build a just and peaceful society. And injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. God's desire is shalom, peace and justice. But violence and injustice stain the world we live in. Injustice and violence are God-sized problems. And the God-sized solution begins and ends in Jesus. If we all dwell in Jesus, and Jesus dwells in all of us, then we will produce much fruit. Without Jesus, we cannot do anything good. We glorify God when we produce much fruit, and this way we prove that we are disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.